I try to make it short so we will enjoy the discussion of the cases with Professor Abdullah and Professor Rao. My topic I am going to discuss in short today, we have used it to perform coronary angiography and PCI via the femoral artery. Why alternative to femoral artery we should think of? Probably because of the local vascular complications, hematomas, hemorrhage, pseudoaneurysms, arterial venous fistula, retroperitoneal hematomas, and a lot of other vascular complications. Prolonged bed rest is and longer hospital stay are uncomfortable to the patient, and we need to have an alternative. If we perform coronary angiography and PCI in electively in patients with chronic stable angina, what is specific for acute coronary syndrome, the topic we are discussing today? In acute coronary syndrome, there is importance of time. The faster is better. In acute coronary syndrome patients, there is a thrombus burden. So we may need a lot of equipments, and extra equipments can be introduced to deal with the thrombus burden. In acute coronary syndrome, there is a tendency for bleeding. Many of these patients will be receiving fibrinolytic therapy, heparin, antiplatelets, and they are more liable to bleeding. Is there any specific concerns about transradial approach in acute coronary syndrome? Actually, feasibility and reperfusion were asked. Reperfusion time and bleeding and percentage, procedural outcome and prognosis. All these points were asked when transradial approach is initiated for PCI in acute coronary syndrome. So these points were tested in femoral artery versus radial artery approach in the entire spectrum of the coronary artery disease. And the results were radial approach reduces mortality and demise and improves safety with a reduction, a major reduction in major bleeding and vascular complication. In patients with or without ST segment elevation and acute coronary syndrome, the same result was obtained. Radial versus femoral in meta-analysis for randomized studies for 17 randomized studies enrolled 19,000 patients, the same benefits. Radial approach was associated with significant reduction in mortality, major bleeding, complication, MACE, and vascular complication. In patients with percutaneous PCI in ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, meta-analysis, radial approach was associated with favorable outcome. In patients with ST segment elevation infarction without cardiogenic shock, excellent procedural success was obtained with lower rate of vascular access complication and hospital mortality. Even in patients treated with prasugrel, transradial approach was associated with a reduction in TME major or minor bleeding. For even following thrombolytic therapy and rescue PCI, complications of mortality miss in patients undergoing PCI after thrombolysis and should be preferred access site choice in this cohort of patients. United Kingdom studies several thousand patients, and the conclusion of the meta-analysis of the studies showed that transradial approach was associated with reduced percutaneous coronary intervention related complications, reduces major adverse cardiac events in more patients, and it should be considered the preferred access site for percutaneous intervention in acute coronary syndrome patients. Another study was conducted, and it was a call to the armies, and they advise that transradial intervention should be involved in cardiovascular fellowship programs and post-fellowship courses and for widespread implantation of the transradial intervention in STEMI patients. Finally, the Egyptian, European Society of Cardiology guidelines in 2015 stated that recommended radial approach for percutaneous coronary intervention in acute coronary syndrome. And in 2017, it was a radial access is recommended over femoral access if performed by an experienced radial operator, and it takes a class 1A recommendation. Recently, the American Heart Association statement for radial artery access for transradial coronary angiography and intervention in acute coronary syndrome, they reviewed 19 randomized trials that involved 21,000 patients, and the endpoints of these were major endpoints with bleeding, vascular complications, and mortality. The final result was they advised transradial across the measured endpoints. It was advantageous in all these points, and actually the statement was shift to a radial first strategy in acute coronary syndrome is recommended. So there is a lot of studies in all types of patients studied the transfemoral versus transradial approach, and they found that it is feasible, it is safe, it reduces local vascular complications and the bleeding, and the outcome, even procedural outcome and the follow-up outcome is very beneficial. But is the door open for everybody to initiate transradial approach in acute coronary syndrome without any concerns? I actually ask this question. One is asking, I have moved from femoral artery to radial artery the last 30 elective coronary angio cases. Can I start right now transradial approach for acute coronary syndrome patients? Another one said, our center started radial access procedure 2 months ago. So the duration of using radial access approach in the center, including doctors, paramedical personnel, and everybody, is just 2 months age. Can we start doing transradial approach for primary PCI in acute coronary syndrome patients? If I have a 55 kilogram female patient with anterior STEMI and blood pressure of 80-60 millimeter mercury, should I start transradial or transfemoral in such patients? I think I have to finish at this point, and I leave Mansour to present his cases, and we will hear from Professor Rao at the end of the talk. Thank you. Mansour, would you like to start your cases now?
Yes, please. Okay, share screen.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Prof. Sameh, for your elegant presentation. As usual, I think you... Sameh, Mansour. Sameh, Mansour. Okay, do you hear me? Okay, I think it was a very nice presentation, Prof. Sameh, that I think will give me excuse about my insistence and the persistence to continue through the radial approach.
I did not finish it. I still have a few slides. I'll present it at the end.
Okay, but I think also you mentioned a very, very nice statement as well about the this course or radial course, I think should be added to fellows as well. I think I would like to appreciate the Prof. Rao. I think radial approach right now becomes a science and art. Prof. Rao, I think, is one of the pioneers on this field. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa qul rabbi zidni ilma. Regarding Al-Azhar radial course, mastering radial approach for coronary procedures. Prof. Rao, we started this course exactly 1.5 months ago. And in this course, the main aim is to teach the juniors about the basics and advanced anatomy of the radial from the digital arteries until the coronaries. So it becomes a science. And art will be learned also from our cases. Exactly as Prof. Sameh mentioned right now, radial access becomes it's not optional and actual fact with Prof. Sameh right now. At the European Society of Cardiology guidelines 2018, it becomes as not optional right now. It is mandatory for any interventional cardiologist to start from the radial approach. Provided that, I think he should learn the pros and the cons of the approach itself. My talk right now, I will present my case right now, but the rationale for radial approach in ischemic elevation myocardial infarction will be given by my dear colleague, Dr. Prof. Rao. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay. I couldn't see, I think your pictures, okay. As I said in the beginning, I prepared the three cases with the graded difficulty. I will start by the most simple one, which actually done by my junior, who did approximately 70 to 80% of this case. Anyhow, she was a female patient, 47, short and obese, hypertensive, presented with extensive anterior ischemic elevation myocardial infarction with ingrained chest pain. However, fortunately, she was hemodynamically stable. My approach is almost always right radial approach until proved otherwise. So, this is her ECG. Just look here, extensive segment elevation, myocardial infarction from V1 to V6. And note as well, there is a segment elevation in one and AVL with reciprocal changes as well in the inferior.
Dr. Mansour, can you make your slide? Because it's out of, we can see, only see part of it.
You can see birth. Okay. So what is happening here, I think? Marianne, do you okay? Are you with us, Marianne?
ابدأ السلايد شو يا منصور على لا
دلوقتي أنا
لا النص الثاني مش باين يا منصور
not seen, yes.
Marianne, any issue here presenter okay.
أنت مكبر الصورة أوي يا منصور
أنا أوكي حاضر لحظة واحدة انت حضرتك شايف السكرين دلوقتي دو سي سكرين دكتور بروفيسور
السكرين بتاع كله لا انت السكرين بتاع الكمبيوتر اوكي انت كده كويس باين انت والولاد والخلفيه اهو
حاضر
اوكي ستارت سلايد شو سكرين شو بقى برزنتيشن يو كان ستارت يور برزنتيشن ناو
It's clear now.
انت بس احنا مش شايفين we couldn't see the PowerPoint presentation. Start the presentation. Have you opened the PowerPoint presentation, Mansour?
Yes, I opened online. I think there is a technical issue here, Dr. Sam. Even if Prof. Rao is ready, I think he can start until I finish this technical issue.
I think that'd be a good idea.
Yeah. So please.
Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you for, again, inviting me to this wonderful conference. I love talking about radial approach. As you know, it's a passion of mine. What I'm going to talk about is how do you approach some of these complex cases like primary PCI? Primary PCI in and of itself may not be complicated from a coronary standpoint, but I think as you heard from the first talk, there is a clock that's ticking, and it's important to make sure that you're able to open these arteries quickly. And sometimes people avoid radial approach because they have the impression that it may take a little bit longer, and they certainly don't want to delay reperfusion. I don't have any disclosures related to this talk, except to say that I am a dedicated transradial operator, so I do have a conflict there when I talk about radial approach. So these are the three things that I'll cover over the next few minutes. Radial approach to primary PCI for STEMI. Why? when, and how should you do it? So let's first talk about the why of why you would want to use radial access for STEMI, especially since femoral approach has been tried and true, and we have all been trained to do femoral access for ST elevation MI. Well, I think you've seen some of these data before. This is the pooled analysis done by the Italian group, looking at four randomized trials that included patients with ST segment elevation. Rival, as you know, included patients with non-ST segment elevation as well. But in this particular study, when you look at the patients who have ST segment elevation MI, and you compare it with patients in the RIFLE STACS study, STEMI radial, and the ST elevation MI patients from Matrix, you see that there is clearly an effect of radial access on reducing major bleeding compared with femoral approach. And importantly, there also seems to be a reduction in all-cause mortality. The mechanism that underlies this may be a reduction in bleeding complications, but it may also be the early mobilization, as Dr. Allam referred to earlier, which is that there is less bed rest in these patients, potentially a lower risk for DVT, and some really intriguing data suggesting that there's a lower effect on kidney injury, potentially also driving some of this mortality benefit. This has all been thrown into a little bit of controversy now with the publication of the SAFARI trial. SAFARI was a randomized trial that had planned to enroll 4,500 patients, 4,484 or so, with ST segment elevation MI, randomized to radial versus femoral access, with a primary endpoint of 30-day mortality. It's been a long time since we've seen a trial focused solely on mortality, but this trial was shown to, was trying to demonstrate whether access site actually influenced mortality. The other trials used mortality as part of a component and as a component of a composite endpoint. Unfortunately, because of secular trends and because of the fact that we had so many trials, these trialists had a very difficult time enrolling patients, and they unfortunately had to stop with only about half of the patients enrolled. So unfortunately, it is in fact underpowered for the primary endpoint of all-cause mortality. So not surprisingly, you can see that there is no significant difference on the left-hand side of the screen. However, interestingly, there was a reduction in major bleeding. And in fact, you could potentially hypothesize that had the trial gone to completion, this probably would have met statistical significance for a reduction in major bleeding with radial access. To the SAFARI trial investigators' credit, they included the SAFARI trial in an overall meta-analysis of all the other radial versus femoral trials. And they found that even if you include SAFARI, which is a neutral trial showing no effect of radial approach, even if you include that trial, there still is an overall benefit of radial access over femoral access in reducing bleeding and improving survival. So that's the why of radial access. And this has certainly been borne out in the adoption of radial approach in the United States. These are old data, almost 10 years old now, showing that there is an increase in radial approach adoption in the US. I can tell you that of 2019, the overall rate of radial approach was over 50% in the United States. So it took us about 12 years. We started talking about this in 2008, but finally in 2020, I can tell you that we're around 53, 54% radial approach for all PCIs, but radial approach for STEMI continues to lag behind. And again, it's probably because of fears of door to balloon time. So again, because of this issue of door to balloon time and the proficiency that's needed for radial approach, when should a team or an operator start thinking about doing radial access for ST elevation MI? We know that as you delay reperfusion, we are sacrificing lives. The faster we can open these arteries, the better the patients do. And this is a really interesting decision analysis that was published by the group at Harvard, asking the question, if you believe that radial approach reduces mortality, how much delay in door to balloon time can we actually tolerate before the mortality effect of radial approach goes away? So these are, this is a decision analysis, so-called using a Markov model, but the underlying assumption in this paper is that you believe that radial approach reduces mortality. So they looked at two randomized trials, RIFLE STACS and RIVAL, and assumed, again, that radial approach reduces mortality. Now this is a little bit of a complicated slide, but what they found was the base case analysis is that radial approach reduces mortality by 50%. That's 0.5 on this x-axis. So if you believe that radial approach reduces mortality by 50%, that means that you can actually delay door to balloon time 85 minutes before that mortality benefit goes away. That's a total door to balloon time of 175 minutes that you can tolerate before radial approach no longer improves survival. Now, let's say you say there's no way 50% mortality benefit is even possible, but maybe a 10% reduction in mortality with radial approaches possible. So then you come over to this 0.9 area on the x-axis, draw a line straight up, and what you can see is that the delay in door to balloon time can be as long as 20 minutes. So even if you believe that there's a marginal effect of radial approach on reducing mortality of only 10%, the data suggests that you can delay door to balloon time by 20 minutes before that mortality benefit goes away. Now, certainly this is not to argue that we should be delaying door to balloon time, but what it does show is that the mortality benefit of radial approach is so robust that door to balloon time can be delayed slightly and you can still get that mortality benefit. But remember that the team that's treating the patient is just as important as the operator who's doing the procedure. So the team, the cath lab team, should have experience with radial approach in elective cases before tackling ST elevation MI. The success of transradial primary PCI is dependent almost entirely on the cath lab staff. It's important to set the patient up for a successful radial procedure because that is the rate limiting approach. At SCAI, the International Professional Society for Interventional Cardiology, and a best practices statement suggested that it is reasonable to start doing primary PCI when the operator and the team has at least 1 year of experience with a radial first approach for elective PCIs, or they've done 100 elective PCI cases with a crossover rate to femoral of less than 4%. And that 4% number is the top volume radial sites in the RIVAL trial had a femoral access site crossover rate of less than 4%. These are expert consensus. There are some operators who are very talented and can start doing radial approach right away for ST elevation MI, but as a simple guiding principle, these seem to be reasonable recommendations. So what are the things you need to keep in mind? Well, you have to have proficiency with radial access. We are big believers in using ultrasound-guided access, particularly for patients who are hypotensive or who are in shock. Remember that balloon-assisted tracking can be extremely useful to traverse complex arm anatomy, and then be proficient with guide extension uses for complex lesions. We know that patients who are older than the age of 75 and who are shorter than 5'5" have a higher rate of subclavian tortuosity on the right side. So in patients who are coming in with an ST elevation MI at our center, where we know the age to be greater than 75, or we know that they are very short patients, we will go with an a priori left radial approach so that we're not stuck delaying the procedure by dealing with the subclavian tortuosity. In this particular study in Canada, patients who were shorter than 5'5" had a much, much lower rate of procedural failure using left radial access. This is our algorithm for ST elevation MI. Patient presenting with ST elevation MI into our emergency department, we will administer early dual antiplatelet therapy, usually with ticagrelor. We will administer unfractionated heparin. They'll come to the cath lab, and if they are over the age of 70 years or less than 5'5" in height, we will use left radial access. Of course, for prior bypass surgery, we use left radial access. And then we will take no longer than 3 minutes to get radial access. If it's taking longer than 3 minutes, we will consider femoral bailout. If it's taking longer than 10 minutes to seat the guide catheter into the infarct-related artery, we will consider bailing out. And if it's taking longer than 20 minutes from radial access to actual first device activation, we will consider bailout to femoral access. Again, these are just guidelines. They are not considered to be regulations or in any kind of law, but these are the kinds of milestones that we keep in mind because, again, door-to-balloon time is very important. Obviously, I want to make one comment about ultrasound-guided access. All of our cath lab rooms now have ultrasound guidance for both radial and femoral access, particularly important if the patient is hypotensive or is in shock. What about balloon-assisted tracking? This is an incredibly useful technique to traverse the arm vasculature. This is a way of simply reducing the transition point between the guide catheter and the guide wire. You will need to wire the arm with an 014 wire, use a 2.0 or 2.25 balloon, so it's 20 millimeters in length, with half of it protruding outside the guide and deployed at 4 atmospheres. That will create a very, very nice transition and will be able to advance up the arm very, very quickly in the case of any kind of radial anomaly or small radial artery. What about guide extensions? Here's a patient who came in with an inferior ST elevation MI. You can see a combination of prior stents as well as heavy calcification in this right coronary artery. Here we anchor the balloon in the lesion and are able to advance a guide extension all the way down to the lesion. And we're very, very easily able to deliver a long 38 millimeter stent to this infarct artery. So become very proficient with guide extension so that you can use radial access for complex procedures. So in summary, I think it's important for centers and operators to start doing transradial primary PCI only after significant experience with elective cases so that they're able to become proficient and problem solve with arm tortuosity or with complex cases. Remember that it's a systems change. It is dependent on the entire team, not just the operator. If the team is not proficient at setting up a good radial case, you'll be very frustrated as an operator. Consider left radial approach for post-CABG patients, older patients and shorter patients, but at the end of the day, remember to use common sense. The clock is ticking and the myocardium is dying. Don't be afraid to bail out to femoral approach if you need to. Thank you very much.
Great. It was great. We enjoyed it too, very much. So you answered some of my questions. Should I finish, Mansoor, before you perform your cases? Do you hear me, Mansoor?
I think you may be muted.
Unmute yourself.
I am unmuted.
No, okay. Mansoor. Do you hear me now?
Mansoor.
I hear you, Prof. Sameh. Do you hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
Do you see my screen?
I can see your screen.
Okay. Is it full, Prof. Abdullah?
No, make it full. You go to
okay. Mansoor, can you give me 5 minutes to finish? Because my talk is related to Professor Please. Rao, and okay. Then we will stay the whole night with you.
Okay, my pleasure. But
do you mind?
Please go, bro. Please.
Okay, thank you. Can you finish? Can you leave share screen, Mansoor?
I left already.
Thank you. Because these are the questions I ask it before we start. Where I am now. These are the questions I ask it before. I have moved from femoral to radial. The last 30 elective coronary artery cases. It's clear from Professor Rao talk, though, no, you are not allowed to start PCI through radial in acute coronary syndrome. Our center started radial access 2 months ago. This is not enough to initiate the program of transradial intervention in your center. Actually, if we reviewed the studies that performed before, there was the European Society of Cardiology, we have said it is stated and shifted to a radial first strategy in acute coronary syndrome is recommended according to the American Heart Association. But if you look at the studies that performed the radial artery obstruction in semi, the radial approach is preferred in STEMI patients when the operator has considerable radial experience. This is what was emphasized in Professor Rao talk. And the femoral artery multicenter randomized trials, it was stated PCI by operators experienced in both access site, radial and femoral. Our findings supported that the use of radial approach in primary PCI is a way of choice after proper training. Proper training. Experts. Transradial intervention in patients with ST elevation and transradial intervention high volume centers. It will be safe and feasible. And again, radial access in ST segment elevation. It is advised based on the current that PCI in STEMI patients appears to be preferred for experienced radial operators. I borrowed this from Professor Rao's previous lecture. Start transradial primary PCI in STEMI only if you have significant experience with elective cases. a significant experience with elective cases through the radial. Please never forget that the primary aim of primary PCI is to restore bleeding blood flow to the infarcted related artery, and the aim is not to avoid accesside complication. So our aim in STEMI is to restore blood flow in the infarcted-related artery, open the artery, save the myocardium, improve the survival of your patient, and improve the benefit of your patient. Professor Rao had said in previous talks, use common sense. The clock is ticking and the myocardium is dying. He said it very fast today, but don't forget that time is muscle. If you, the longer you lose the time, the more the muscles you'll lose. The statement of the American Heart Association, which supports the transradial artery access for coronary angioplasty, one important point outside in the document, the operators, not only the operators, but the operators and the cath lab teams should become very professional in transradial approach in non-emergent cases prior to deploying the radial in primary PCI. I would say that radial operators should use radial artery in STEMI, and femoral artery operators should use femoral artery in STEMI. Thank you. I have finished, Mansoor, and
stop your screen. Stop your screen, Professor.
If there is any comment from the panelists,
I think you know the both of you, Dr. Rao and Dr. Son, you know, so both of you presented nicely the convincing reason for using the radial. I mean, this is maybe if you speak to the operators 20 years ago, they will not believe you. But now the evidence, you know, the data from everywhere. I think US was maybe the latest to follow the radial. I mean, Europe and the Middle East, I think we now more than 90% of our, you know, angiography, especially the STEMI, are, you know, radial. And I think really the benefit of radial seen in the STEMI as, and of course you need to be done adequate quality numbers of cases electively to be able to do the STEMI cases. I think, you know, the mortality and morbidity and the safety nicely described by Prof. Rao and Dr. Allam. And really the importance of the tools. You know, the problem we forget about the tools. Some people want to start radial, they don't have the tools. And the staff are not trained. It's not one person, you know, I think everyone should be comfortable with this. And then both of you nicely said, you know, you need to be trained in both, actually, you know, because nowadays we go with the complex, with the chip kind of cases, you know, we need to have hemodynamic support. We need to have a femoral access as well. So I think a great presentation, both of you.
Thank you.
You see my presentation now, Prof. Abdullah?
Okay, go ahead.
Show us. You see full screen?
Not yet.
Not yet. Something incredible, yeah, Allah. You see? Advanced.
Stop share and share again. Maybe yes, can be.
Okay. We can see it, Mansoor.
Make okay. A big.
We agreed, Mansoor. This is very nice.
That's okay. Alhamdulillah. Prof. Rao, a very nice presentation as usual. I think you make also my presentation, inshallah, will be easy. However, I would like to say from the beginning, the algorithm that you presented right now should be individualized as well. In my previous center that I worked, we worked almost 100% radial, and our door to balloon time was approximately 22 minutes. So it was great. I would like to present this case was considered to be a little bit easy case, female, 47, short, obese, hypertensive, presented with extensive anterior ischemic elevation myocardial infarction with ingoing chest pain. Fortunately, she was hemodynamically stable, extensive ischemic elevation with, as you see, ischemic elevation as well, N1 and AVL. I think Prof. Rao right now clearly illustrated the diagnostic approach. Anyhow, I would like to ask you as the operators, because every minute counts in a single television myocardial infarction, and we have to see. When you see a patient like that with anterior ST division and would expect LAD, which catheter you would like to prefer first? Is it diagnostic right, then go to the left guide, or what is your approach, Prof?
Yeah, so there's a very, very nice paper from the group in Quebec City in Canada that looked at anterior infarctions and whether shooting the non-involved artery, so the right coronary, versus just going up with a guide catheter and the effect that it had on door to balloon time. And it shortened the door to balloon time by about 5 to 7 minutes. Now for inferior STEMIs, it's complicated because sometimes you don't know if it's the circumflex, sometimes you don't know if it's the right coronary. Anterior though, it's pretty clear that it's the LAD. So my practice has changed so that when someone comes with an anterior ST elevation MI, I go up right away with a left coronary guide. And I go ahead and do the primary PCI. And then I always ask the nurse, remind me to shoot the right coronary, because otherwise I'll forget. And, you know, I'll open the artery, I'll be very happy with the result, and then I'll take off my gloves. And then the nurse says, no, you forgot to shoot the right. So I have to remember to shoot the right coronary. But I think you get a little bit faster door to balloon time if you just go with the guide right away.
Prof. Abdullah would like to add, Prof. Sameh?
I echo what Prof. said. Really, the inferior is the problem. When you get the inferior, you don't know what to do. That's why I mean, in the beginning, I used to go with a guide which go for left and right. You know, you can do that, but now I've adjusted myself.
Exactly as you said, Prof. Abdullah, this is my approach. Whenever available, usually I use in my practice in all acute coronary syndrome patients, either STEMI or non-STEMI, single catheter, whenever available, Tiger, 60 French guides, it was available. And usually this is my practice, and I think I have support from the literature about safety and efficacy of using a single catheter. It saves time and it saves money. And I think also it, from technical point of view, we shouldn't change many catheters. This is the rationale of using radial approach. So single catheter, it's all in vast majority situations.
Sorry, Mansoor, if you have Tiger catheter that could engage either the right coronary artery or the left coronary artery, and you have anterior STEMI, do you shoot the right coronary first or the left first?
Yes. Usually I shoot the right first, then go to the left. If inferior, I shoot the left first, and I go to the right after that. But anyhow, it is one single catheter. If I would like to do complete revascularization, I will do both. Okay? So I have support from literature. Anyhow, Tiger was not available. So for this patient, I shoot it the right first by the GR catheter. It was very clear there is a significant ostial RCA lesion and the rest of RCA was fine. Just for sake of time, I presented this view only. There was no retrograde collateral to LED. Anyhow, I shifted immediately.
We are seeing the first slide only, Mansoor.
And the second one?
No.
Can you go to wider screen, Mansoor?
So you have to go to slideshow mode, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, go to slideshow mode, and then you can see that.
Okay. Do you see this now?
Yes, you can see the angiograms now, yes.
Okay, so this is the left system. It is very clear that right now the left circumflex is a little bit small, and there is medium size, very high OM with intermediate lesion. But it is clear here, as you see, the LAD is recognized. However, the patient is still having chest pain. What do you expect from where this problem happens or this chest pain, persistent chest pain despite TIMI 3 flow? Go to this slide. Do you see post right now? LED, there is a tight lesion in the mid segment right now, as you see. But if you can see clearly, there is diagonal branch. There.
It's not moving, Mansoor.
Dr. Mansoor, if you go to slide, you know, make the slide bigger, you know.
I think you need to go to slideshow. I don't think you're in slideshow mode.
I am a slideshow. I am on a slideshow mode.
Yeah, I think we're seeing your slides on the left-hand side still. All of your slides.
You are not in slideshow, Mansoor. Yes, okay. Put this button.
Okay. Do you see both now?
We can see both. No, we can see the other slides on the left-hand side. So you are not on slideshow mode yet.
I'm on a slideshow. I'm on a slideshow mode.
طب انت شايف السلايدز بتاعتك اللي yes. على شمالك دي؟
Yes, both are very clear.
No.
لا. كنت سلايد شو يا دكتور منصور،
في فوق عندك في
الفوق. حبيبي والله
انا ام اون. طول بص يا منصور، طول ما انت شايف على ايدك الشمال سلايدز يبقى انت مش على السلايد شو. لا ما انت شايف الاثنين بس انت مش
Did you get now?
Not slide show, Mansoor.
Yeah, just hit play from current slide. You see that on the top there? It says play from current slide. If you click that.
على كل سلايد يا منصور. On each slide, there is an arrow. You can press it and it will start moving. Okay.
دكتور منصور، روح على اليسار فوق بالارو وpress on play. From start, you know, go with your mouse to the top. Yeah, go up.
Press the slide.
Play from start. You know, that's what it says.
Okay, play from the start.
Yeah,
okay.
It's like that. Go. You pressed. It's not going. Something wrong. Something strange with your.
Yeah, first time happened actually. Okay, we presented many times. So you don't see right now. I see it very clear right now in my computer.
It's not moving at all. It's just freezed.
Okay. So you see this issue. Okay.
Maybe
so
try I think. Out again and try again. Go out of the slide and just try again.
Okay. Do you see the slide right now?
Slide. We see them, but they're just not. They're not in slideshow mode for us.
White road. Marianne with us or not?
هي مريم مش هتقدر تعمل حاجة من صور لأن ده الكمبيوتر بتاعك أنت. Share بقى the screen دلوقتي. Share the screen يا منصور. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Okay. Share screen بقى. Open your presentation يا منصور.
Still not seen?
No, we could see you.
Advancing. Version of screen.
Came back to the out of range. Out of range.
Out of range.
Big for us.
Magnified قوي يا منصور. Magnified بحيث ان احنا شايفين we could see the balloon or the stent only. The two wires at the end. But we couldn't see the guiding catheter. Magnified.
So if I ask maybe Prof, while you are you still struggling, so you can start the discussion maybe.
You can discuss.
Prof Sameh, in your institution, when did you started the radial, and why?
Actually, we started it recently. And Mansoor was one who encouraged us to initiate the radial program. So I myself don't have enough experience to perform radial in every case. But a lot of our colleagues, the junior staff, are usually enthusiastic, and they started earlier than we did.
Right.
But I'll go back to the case presented by Mansoor. If you have a patient with extensive anterior myocardial infarction, and you wanted to start the procedure, I usually feel very happy to know the status of the right coronary artery before I start dilating the LED or the lift system. So if I am confronted with anterior MI, an LED lesion, then at the end of the procedure, I found that the RCA is 90% stenosis somewhere mid-segment or distal. What should I do?
Yeah, so it's a good question. And certainly we have some data now, as you know, that the complete trial but I think clearly demonstrating that treating all major epicardial stenoses in a patient with ST elevation MI is associated with a better outcome. Now, the question ultimately is, should you do it in the hospital before the patient leaves, or can you bring the patient back? In the trial, it didn't really matter the timing of that non-culprit artery PCI. The vast majority of the ones that were done in the hospital were very, very severe stenoses, usually 90% or worse. So in a patient like that, we've generally, if it's 90% in the non-culprit artery, we would fix that patient's artery, not in the same setting, but before the patient went home. If it's less than a 90% and it's in, you know, the non-culprit artery, depending on the patient's clinical status, we may actually bring them back anywhere between 2 to 4 weeks and fix that stenosis electively. But I think there's no question now that in a patient who has an ST elevation MI who has non-culprit stenoses, the randomized data demonstrate that we really should pursue revascularization of those stenoses.
If you find your patient, you have opened the LAD, you have stented it, restored the blood flow, and the patient is hemodynamically stable, creatinine level and the glomerular filtration rate is normal, you used a few milliliters of dye, why not opening the RCA at the same time?
Yeah, I think that's a very reasonable approach. I tend to be a little bit more superstitious, and I think that when I get a good result, the gods of angioplasty get angry if I try to get too aggressive. So I tend to take the victory and then usually let the patient recover and fix the other artery at an elective date. But certainly at the same time would be very, very reasonable, particularly I think there are some guide catheters now that can shoot both the right and the left, like the Ikari guide. It's not a very supportive guide, but it's a very easy guide to use. And I think if you had a very uncomplicated LAD PCI, went very quickly, I think you can withdraw the guide, flip it around to the right coronary and go ahead and fix that as well.
Okay, I'll consider one scenario again, because I had a problem with one of my patients. I started doing the LAD because it was anterior MI. Unfortunately, there was a very large thrombus burden. No reflow occurs in the LAD, and it turned it to be a very disastrous condition because the RCA has a very critical lesion and the LCX was small. It does not support me enough. In such a situation, if you know the anatomy of the LAD and you have found the thrombus burden, small LCX, and the tight RCA lesion, do you start doing the RCA first just to give you some support?
We haven't been. And again, some of that may be, I think from a clinical standpoint, it's an interesting discussion to have. Certainly in this country, as an operator, I actually am graded by what my door to balloon time is. So I will, the next day after my call, I will get a progress report of all of my STEMIs and what my door to balloon time was. And those are now publicly reported by the US government. So, we tend to just fix the infarct artery initially and then, deal with the consequences. It's an interesting discussion though, because you're right, particularly in patients who have multivessel coronary disease, and it looks like probably 10 to 15% of patients who come in with ST elevation MI will have non-culprit stenoses. If you do have a complication with your infarct artery, particularly the LAD, that can really lead to a lot of trouble in some of these patients.
I think, Prof. Allam, we've all been through these scenarios, and we have different approach every time. I think, with the data, as Prof. Rao said, the complete, I think it's really give us lots of options now to do it on while we are doing the culprit. We can at the same time finish everything, or we can do it in hospital, We could do it after. But you know, with during COVID, Prof. Allam, COVID pandemic, yes, you know, yes, we've yes. seen cases really like two culprits at the same time, you know, and that's even uh-huh. the ECG, you know, suggests maybe one thing, but you see the other artery is more thrombotic. But it's very interesting, I think, discussion.
Anyhow, I think the decision is individualized. According to the situation you are, you may change even your policy during the procedure. But are you still using aspiration catheters in a primary PCI with a STEMI? How frequent do you use it?
We're using it very rarely now. You know, we use it only as a bailout. If, for example, after the initial balloon dilation shows a residual very, very heavy thrombus burden, that's when we'll use it. I think it's important to make sure for those who are using aspiration thrombectomy that you use it in a way that reduces the risk of stroke. Look at the randomized trials of thrombectomy. There is a higher risk of stroke. Some of that may be because of the lack of maintaining suction as you withdraw the catheter back into the guide. And remember, make sure you keep the suction negative, pull the catheter back into the guide, and then make sure that you bleed back the hemostatic valve.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's very nice.
You see my screen now or not?
Prof. Rao, you know, what about this active aspiration? You know, it's available now. It's like Penumbra, which we're using for the... You are using that. And I mean, this is... I've used it first, I think, in the whole Middle East. So it was a very interesting case because that was too much thrombus. Yeah. I was not able to do with the passive one. This active one was really good result, but I don't know what's the situation.
Yes. It's a very, very intriguing device, I think. And I would love to see more data on it. It's, you know, certainly, you know, when I was training, which is a long time ago, we would use some AngioJet, which is obviously a very complicated device. Penumbras looks very attractive. I would love to see some actual data on it in ST elevation MI, because as Dr. Allam mentioned, you know, heavy thrombus burden is a very, very challenging thing to deal with in STEMI.
But do you use intracoronary fibrinolytic therapy in such cases?
I have. I've used it. I think that whether the results that I've seen are due to the fibrinolytics or just because I allowed a little bit of time and the antithrombotic therapy to take effect, I don't know. You know, I think the data certainly suggests that there's not much of an effect of intracoronary lytics. But again, you know, it's very challenging to apply large data sets to individual patients, right? I mean, in patients, every STEMI is a little bit different. And I think when you have a patient who's very sick, you have to use the strategies, every strategy that's available.
That's right.
The best outcome.
That's right.
Yeah. You see my screen now or not?
Yes, beautiful now. Beautiful.
Yes.
Okay. I switched off the computer completely and I return it back to you. So if you remember this case, I started by the diagnostic right GR. There is a tight osteal lesion. I gave nitroglycerin and it's suspected. So I think it is a true osteal lesion. And here, as you see, I started by the guide lift. LED, as you see, is almost TIM 3. Okay. Here, there is a tight lesion in the mid segment. However, the TIM 3 flew as well. But where is the diagonal? There is a shadow of the occluded diagonal branch. I think this explains the segment elevation in the lateral in one and the AVL. So I buzzed the wire intentionally. I was going to place it in the LED, but it went by itself into diagonal branch, and I found without any intervention, diagonal branch is a very big branch. So I buzzed a balloon. It was very nice, and I ended by this picture before I do anything. So it is a huge single diagonal branch, and I extended the mid segment. And this is the result. At this time, the patient chest pain completely off. So right now, I have a TIM3 flow, extended the mid segment, and I have a lesion here in the osteal diagonal branch together with the LED and the almost proximal mid segment. Please.
Dr. Mansour, why do you think it's not LED? It's LED. Why do you think it's diagonal?
What do you mean? What?
I think the lesion you opened is LED, it's not diagonal.
Yes, it's LED, yes. This is LED. I am talking about the diagonal branch bifurcation of the LED and the diagonal branch. What to do next for this lesion?
No, okay. Dr. Abdullah has asked Mansour, which is LED?
This is the LED.
The one which was totally occluded or the...
No, the totally occluded was the diagonal branch. And the LED was patent. as you see from this picture, it doesn't go back. But anyhow, this is LED, Dr. Abdullah. It was a 90% lesion with TIMI-3 flow. This is the diagonal branch. I didn't do anything for it right now, but flow markedly improved after wire passage. And there is osteal, true osteal diagonal branch with LED lesion at the site of the diagonal branch.
So this is
TIMI-3 flow. Yeah.
This is 0-1.
Yeah, 0-1. But okay, I think in other views you will see, you will see this LED lesion. I think it's more tight, more than 50%.
So I can. Have you put in a Spider-Man sort?
Yeah, I took it. This is Dr. Sameh. This is Spider. Okay. Anyhow, the spider and other view, no problem. So okay. Shall I stop here or shall we do bifurcation lesion? With, if we will do bifurcation, is provisional or two-stent technique, and which technique if you will do an intervention? What do you think?
So very challenging situation. I mean, it's a very large diagonal. I mean, congratulations on finding the infarct artery. I think it's very challenging to do that. And then the lesion itself comes all the way to the LED. I think my personal view is that you probably are obligated to put a stent there just so you reduce the risk of abrupt closure. And what I would do is leave a wire down the LED and probably try to cover the ostium. The angulation there is somewhat favorable. In other words, it's a little bit more of a T than you think. So you may be able to land the stent just at the ostium of the LED, of the diagonal without compromising the LED. But if you do compromise the LED, you're going to have to be prepared to do some kind of complex bifurcation technique there, I think.
Prof. Abdullah?
Well, I think, Annie, for me, the diagonal should be tackled here. Should, I mean, that's, I think, the culprit for me. I don't know, the LED, I think LED is already open, but I mean, culprit, yeah. I think, for me, is diagonal.
I don't know, Mansoor. The LED just distal to the ostium of the diagonal is unhealthy. Okay. Yes, this segment is unhealthy. I don't know if you stint the diagonal, what could happen in this LED. And if you try to provisionally stint the diagonal only and putting the proximal segment, the proximal of the proximal part of the stent just at the ostium of the diagonal, you have to keep away to re-enter this LED and don't leave the stent of the diagonal to protrude too much into the LED. So your life will be very difficult if you try to redilate the LED distant to the diagonal. So you have to
Very valid points, Prof. Sameh, exactly as you mentioned. And I think there is another issue that I would like to iterate, which is a single diagonal branch, especially in females. Usually I saw many patients when this diagonal branch occludes, hell happens. And usually many patients enter into ventricular fibrillation in a situation of single diagonal. So I think this should be a precious vessel to us. We should protect. And of course, yes, we should protect LED as well. If you see the angle, very, very narrow angle here, it's almost 20 or less than 30 degree. Exactly as you mentioned, here the LED is unhealthy. So I think I have to protect the post. So I think for my strategy that I did prefer to do DK crush for this lesion to protect both of them. And I think we have an evidence from the literature right now from the DK crush 2 randomized trial that should clearly evidence benefit of two-stent technique even in situations of segment elevation myocardial infarction. These are the step-by-step approach, but I think we don't have time to explain. This is the stent deployment in the diagonal branch. It was, by the way, it was 318 branch, okay, in the diagonal branch. Okay, this is the first crush, first kiss. Okay, second kiss, second crush, sorry. And this is, I think this is the before final branch, for final situation. Second kiss, and I didn't have, to be frank with you, shorter balloon than that. If I have shorter balloon, so I think it will be optimal put. And this is the final result that we got right now. Nice flow in both. T3 flow was almost 0% residual stenosis, and the patient was clinical and hemodynamically stable with no chest pain. So this is the DK crush, considered to be a little bit complex situation in a setting of astigmatic elevation myocardial infarction through radial approach.
Beautiful result, really looks terrific.
Thank you so much. Okay.
What about the OCL RCA?
Okay, this is my second question right now to the panelists. Okay, shall I stop here or shall I continue BCI in the same setting?
I think this was enough complex, okay? You know, I think you should give a rest to yourself and to the patient.
Yeah, and right. When to do next session? And when to do RCA, Prof. Abdullah?
Well, it depends. I know, for me, I work in both private and government. You know, when I work in private, I let the patient go home, but in government, we have more options to do it in hospital.
So if it is governmental patient, what will you do?
In the hospital. I will do it in two, three days after this session.
Prof. Rao?
Yeah, I would do the same thing. After DK crush, I'm so tired that I would have to let patient recover, myself recover, and probably bring the patient back in a day or two before discharge and fix the right and the OM.
Okay, so I think exactly as you said, Prof. Abdullah, Prof. Rao, I do agree about that. I think in summary, complete trial, complete revascularization is advisable in patients with significant elevation myocardial infarction, either immediately, but I think otherwise I was exhausted as well. And before the discharge, we did as well, before the hospital discharge, RCA done as well. It was also from the same right radial approach. And this is a key in our mind. We have to protect radial artery from occlusion and we have to do our best. How to minimize radial artery occlusion, I think this will be another task in our course, inshallah. This is the GR from the right radial approach, 3 days after the first attack. The stenting, ballooning, I think it was a fine result as well. And this is the final result. If you would like to comment, any comment about the stent was precise.
Mansoor, after 3 days when you started to dilate the RCA, have you checked the lymph system first?
Sure, it was fully patent.
Sure.
I checked all the
okay. Yes. Okay, yes. So this is a very important point we have to. And the strategies of dilating multivessel disease in acute coronary syndrome, you should not leave the RCA until the patients get symptoms. So it should not be a symptom-driven procedure or decision, but you have to decide either in the indexed PCI, but you were tired, the patient was tired, it was a bifurcation lesion, so before the patient goes home, or in just 2-3 weeks, electively later, but don't leave the patient to come complaining of another chest pain because of increasing the severity of the OCL RCA lesion.
Yeah, that's an important point because remember in the complete trial, the difference between the two strategies was driven by a reduction in spontaneous MI. So this is one of the first trials to show that PCI of non-culprit lesions reduces subsequent myocardial infarction. So that's a very, very important finding.
Yes. Okay. Now the lessons we learned from this case that we can summarize, radial access is feasible in STEMI. This patient, as I told you, 70-80% of the procedure was done by my junior colleague. Complex procedures as bifurcation lesion can be done in the setting of astigmatic elevation myocardial infarction and proper timing of non-culprit, I think we'll discuss right now. And the reuse of the same radial artery, I think, is very, very important to preserve its patency. We'll discuss later, inshallah. The first case I told it is just a piece of cake because the test was nice and easygoing, whatever, when there's no any problems. But I would like to share with you this little bit difficult case.
For me, our patient, it was not easy, Mansoor.
No, Prof, you are my Prof. I think you're my mentor.
I couldn't say it's easy with bifurcation stenting.
It was. As I told you, it was done by my resident, my junior colleague, but I was sitting with him. Second patient, male, 84, hypertensive, type 2 diabetic, acute inferior segmental elevation, myocardial infarction, and just please, button red lines at 2 o'clock. And the patient presented with ongoing chest pain. This is his ECG. Straightforward. Segment elevation with reciprocal changes. So I think Prof. Rao right now clearly mentioned about the access site in octogenarian patient, and I prepared many questions, but I think I will skip right now. Shall we start from right radial, left radial, right femoral? Unfortunately, I was out of view. I switched my computer, but I hear that I think left radial approach should be in any octogenarian patient, but unfortunately we didn't listen to Prof. Rao in this patient. And I think this advantage of the left radial approach, this is, I think, a very, very nice statement about to use radial artery access in patients with segment elevation myocardial infarction. In actual fact, left radial is preferred in elderly patients because of high incidence of subcalabrian tortuosity. But unfortunately, we didn't listen to that statement and went to the right radial approach as our default approach. What do you think?
This is very interesting. Did this patient have some kind of trauma or something to their arm? Because atherosclerosis outside the chest cavity is very, very unusual to have this kind of an occlusion. The last time I saw an occlusion like this outside the chest cavity was in a patient who, when we spoke with him, he was an 80-year-old patient. And we asked him, he said, yeah, he had received a dog bite when he was 6 years old in that arm. And because of that, he had occluded the artery. And it's very unusual to see this.
But after two pictures, I think it will be explained to you. It was no trauma, nothing at all. But anyhow, this is the CTO of the proximal brachial artery with bridging collaterals and completely filled the hand with brachial artery. So what to do next? Okay. My approach, Prof. Rao, this is my approach. It's my challenge to rediscourse over rate from radial to femoral. Almost always, I don't go femoral almost at all. This is my paper, RURU. I called it as RURU, right radial, right ulnar, right, left radial, left ulnar, stands for. So when I fail right radial, usually I go to the ipsilateral ulnar. If I failed, I go to left radial, then left ulnar. But in this situation, I think I couldn't go to the ulnar, right ulnar, because they already the street is blind.
It's a brachial artery.
What, Prof. Sameh? So what shall I do?
Definitely, the right radial have this anatomy, and the brachial has the same anatomy. So if you go through the right ulnar, it's waste of time. There is no need to try the ulnar and this arm again. And what happened in the left arm?
What is wrong with the left? This is my question to you. Shall I listen to Prof. Rao's recommendation, or shall I go to the left radial or right femoral? What do you think?
Actually, Mansoor, in the 84 years old man, I do expect subclavian anomalies. I do expect aortic arch diseases. I do expect a lot of problems in the aortic, in the great vessels in the aortic arch in this elderly man. And if we count time to balloon, we are wasting time in trying radial in acute inferior myocardial infarction in this patient. I myself will switch directly to save time to femoral approach.
Prof. Rao?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's very reasonable. I mean, I guess in our lab, because we're so used to doing radial, we would have started with left radial. But in this case, I probably would have bailed to left radial. Our staff is very, very quick at setting it up.
Exactly, as I told you, this is my approach, okay? I would like to shift immediately to the left radial, but there was an urge from the technician and the nurses at 2 a.m. Please go down, go to the femoral. Despite what I learned from my extensive experience in such situations, okay? when the street is not paved up, believe me, Prof. Sameh, it will not be paved down as well. You will face a problems down, okay?
I'm sure. Okay. In 84 years old, you will expect a calcified femorals. Yeah. You will find iliofemoral disease. You will find abdominal aortic aneurysms. And even if you reach the coronaries, you will find a very extensive calcific lesions in this age group. So,
okay. So I think I, unfortunately, I listened to them, to the technician and the nurse, and I went. And I found this way. Unfortunately, we didn't have during that time long sheaths to overcome. This is tortuosity, marked tortuosity in the right iliac, and we could reach by the diagnostic left catheter by very, very extreme difficulty. I could reach to the left coronary artery. It was non-selective injection. And I, unfortunately, I couldn't pull the right Judkin from the left, from this right femoral approach. Okay, so I am stuck right now. What shall I do also? Shall I do go to left radial or to go to left femoral? To make it short, just this is the same picture. I think it will be waste of time to go from this approach right now. Just see how many tortuosity here. There is one tortuosity. Two, three, four, and at the end, there is a lesion here, or there is marked tortuosity. So I think it will be a waste of time, Prof. Sameh, to go to from the left femoral. So I think I will go to immediately, okay, to the left.
You will lose. You will lose the length of the catheter before you could reach the ascending aorta.
And I think you may have vascular complications, very, very common in such situations. Prof. Rao. Yes, it was not a dog bite. It was nothing at all. So I think it was a hell. Okay, this is bilateral brachial artery. Yeah. Okay, the first right was occluded completely, and this is almost high grade 99% or 95% lesion. So
the wrong night to be on. Abdullah.
Yeah. At 2 o'clock. Prof. Abdullah, what to do?
And how's the patient, by the way?
What?
How's the patient by this time? You've gone.
The patient's still having chest pain. He's still having ongoing pain.
I think that's the only option you have here. You have to go lift. You know, this is where you have to. You have to continue through this. I mean, you can open it. No, you can go with your guide with the wire through this.
Okay, Prof. Rao.
Yeah, I would probably use balloon-assisted tracking here and just go through that stenosis, fix the coronary, make sure the patient's stabilized, and then potentially stent this on the way out.
Exactly. Prof. Allam.
Agreed. Okay. Try to go through this lesion, but you have to treat it. You have to treat the this brachial artery.
You see, Prof. Rao, it was a very easy task. The wire went by itself without balloon assist tracking, without anything. It was very, very nice. Okay. And I went to the right coronary artery, left, as I told you that we have seen it. And there is a high grade, highly thrombotic lesion, okay, in the distal LRC. Okay. Was very easy task. So what about? Sir, shall I use aspiration thrombectomy here or not?
No.
No need.
Okay.
Shall I do direct stenting or shall I pre-dilate? No.
Can you look at the angio first? I mean, is it calcified or not? I mean, just on
I would prefer to dilate and to cut it short. Dilate because it is calcified and there is a thrombus just at the end of the tight stenosis.
I don't see any calcification on that CINI. I mean, for STEMI, I really normally go direct stenting, but again, it varies.
No.
Here, I don't see any calcification.
Yeah, I mean, I prefer to pre-dilate in STEMI just because I think that there is a risk of undersizing stents in STEMI. I prefer to pre-dilate, but you know, you have what looks like at least TIMI 2 flow, if not TIMI 3 flow. So if you wanted to direct stent, I don't think that would be a terrible thing. Sometimes in the 84-year-olds, you can't see angiographic calcification, but you may have a fibrotic lesion that's a little bit hard to expand. So again, it's another reason to pre-dilate. But if you wanted to attempt a direct stent, and you know, it sounds like you've spent quite a bit of time already on this case. So, you know, it's worth a try, I guess.
Anyhow, I didn't aspirate really, and I would like to be frank with you to raise this issue of direct stenting versus pre-dilatation in ischemic elevation myocardial infarction, but unfortunately for the technical issues that happened, I will skip, and I think there is no consensus about to do direct stent or not, based on many studies and many meta-analyses. And this is 2020, there is a MRA study that didn't show any difference between both of them. So what I did for this patient, to be frank with you, I did pre-dilatation by small balloon 2-0, and this is the final result. And the result was satisfactory. The patient was very fine, and he went very well. So lessons learned from this case as well, in presence of brachial CTO in a ischemic elevation myocardial infarction, we have to cross immediately. And when you have a brachial tight lesion, I think we can negotiate either by the wire itself or by balloon assist tracking, as you said. In octogenarians, I think, please, we have to start from the beginning, from the left radial, irrespective of the issue. Okay. So,
did they smoke?
This patient?
Yeah.
No, there's no smoke. Yeah. Third case is radial stem.
Before enter this, Mansour, have you put a drug-eluting stent or permethyl stent?
No, it's a drug-eluting stent.
And why not permethyl in this patient?
But why not? Is it a segment elevation? And I think there is clear evidence of drug-eluting stent as compared to the permethyl stent. Almost in since 2009, I didn't use, or 2008, I didn't use the bare metal.
I know, but not in every patient. In a patient who is 84, I don't know how safe the antiplatelet for this patient. Yeah. I'm not sure if he can remember taking antiplatelet regularly for a year or so or not. The incidence of bleeding in 84 years old is higher. He may fall at any time and they get fractured neck femur and require surgery. So there is a lot of concerns about the age. I'm not thinking of comparing a drug-eluting stent with permethyl stent, but in such a situation, I'm asking colleagues, do you consider permethyl stents in such cases or?
No, I think there's a very nice meta-analysis by Steve Ellis that shows that current generation drug-eluting stents are actually safer than bare metal stents with respect to stent thrombosis. So we haven't used a bare metal stent in our lab in probably 5 years.
Mm-hmm. We have also Onyx right now, Dr. Sameh, proved evidence of one month depth even. But I don't think in the segment elevation myocardial infarction we'll keep it for 1 month. Okay, 30 cases, it comes out of a hole, then falls into a well. In Arabic, to translate, okay, just when to solve a problem, there is another bigger problem to have. Okay, so our patient today admitted with us or admitted at 21st of May at the beginning of COVID-19 peak in Egypt. So this is one of the problems that we'll start with. 43-year-old female patient, morbidly obese, hypertensive diabetic, chest pain for 13 hours, history of atrial fibrillation, persistent atrial fibrillation, and she was on warfarin and verapamil. That's it, together with the insulin. When I saw patient in my private clinic, the patient was fully conscious, apprehensive, and markedly pale and profuse. In actual fact, she was in full-blown picture of cardiac shock. This is her ECG in my private clinic, a segment elevation myocardial in inferior
or lateral.
Okay, so I shifted here to my university hospital, Babi Shahriye or Sayyid Jalal Hospital immediately. There is another ECG confirming the diagnosis. We did right ventricular lead as well as posterior lead. And I think it is very clear right now we have associated right ventricular function, associated posterior wall myocardial function. Do you agree?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So bedside echocardiography done in the era of COVID-19, no mechanical complication, mild to moderate mitral regurgitation, mildly dilated left ventricle with expected ejection fraction low, and INR was 2.2. Just I would like to remember, I think the only hope for this patient right now is to use primary VCI with full PPE in the COVID-19. Okay, so just I would like to count the problems that we started with, the extensive inferior segment elevation myocardial infarction, cardiogenic shock, peak of COVID-19, young morbidly obese patient with INR 2.2. Just I would like to add, I didn't mention in this count, the technician was not available and one of my colleagues started to move the table and to act as a technician. So just to add. In this situation, Prof. Rao, my almost 100%, I am using 100% in all patients categories, cardiogenic shock, cabbage patient, segment elevation myocardial infarction. Shall we give vasodilatory cocktail as a usual in this patient or not?
Yeah, I mean, we tend to use verapamil, which is at a very, very low dose. The effect on systemic blood pressure is very negligible, so we tend to do it. Even if the blood pressure is low, we give 2.5 milligrams of verapamil, and it's just enough to facilitate the passage of our catheters.
Okay. Prof. Abdullah?
Okay,
no, I don't get all this situation. Yeah, I don't think the vasodilatory cocktail when blood pressure is 80 over 50 in case of bradycardia, hypotension, cardiogenic shock. Even Prof. Rao, I don't give any verapamil in patients with inferior ischemic elevation myocardial function, anticipating any conduction problems, and also in extensive anterior ischemic elevation myocardial function, anticipating myocardial stunning, and patient may deteriorate. So this is my approach. But if blood pressure is high, definitely I will give metroglycerin if blood pressure allows. What about infarctionated heparin, 2.2 INR? Shall I give or not?
So that's a great question. And we could probably discuss this for an hour because we don't really have a lot of data. I mean, the reason to give unfractionated heparin is to reduce radial artery occlusion, prevent thrombus on the equipment. You need to have some antithrombin activity. We just don't know how much to give. So we tend to give half dose for our 2,500 units, for example. This is a very obese patient. I don't know if you have bivalirudin available in your country. We tend to use that. But otherwise, I think in a STEMI situation, I think you have to get your ACT therapeutic. Warfarin will not do it. So I would give full dose heparin here. I think you're going radial, so the risk of bleeding is low. The only thing you have to watch out for is forearm hematoma. That's the only thing you have to be careful of.
Exactly. Okay. I think,
but Mansoor, you have to be very cautious with the cocktail in right ventricular infarction and the blood pressure of 80 over 50. If you give any, the filling pressure of the right ventricle is very important. Vasodilatation with the very minimal doses of nitroglycerin may cause severe hypotension and shock. So you have to be very cautious in using nitroglycerin in these patients.
I didn't give for these patients. But remember, INR 2.2 and the Prof. Rao right now elects for full dose heparin. Meaning that by any way, I shouldn't go back to the femoral. So please, Prof. Sameh, irrespective of what will happen, don't say, please go to femoral. Okay? Let us agree about that. Say yes, Prof. Sameh. Okay. So anyhow, this is the first infection. We face the resistance to buzz the wire. So I think the first one, as we recommended before, once you encounter resistance, so we have to have to visualize forearm angiography. I think we explained this picture before, and we mentioned that any parallel artery to the brachial artery will be one of three. Could be the high thickness of radial artery, accessory radial artery, or recurrent radial artery. So for me, I think it's very, very clear. This is the high thickness of radial artery with intense, very long spasm that usually don't respond to extra doses of vasodilatory cocktail that we didn't give it already. Okay? The patient is in cardiogenic shock. The patient is going. So immediately, I took a wire, okay, and I did my best to go. Unfortunately, the wire didn't go. Hamster, what to do?
This is a great case for balloon-assisted tracking.
You are very, very nice guy. Okay, so nitroglycerin, I will not give nitroglycerin. I will not, never, Prof. Sameh, I will not never cross over. Okay, so exactly, I will listen to Prof. Rao. Okay, this is balloon-assisted tracking.
Prof. Mansoor, this patient, should have gone left from left side, I'm saying. This is really ideal for left side, radial.
Left side. What is the rationale for left side?
I mean,
is the rationale?
No, she's obese and, you know, it's very, very easier access, you know, to get to the, you know, without any manipulation, especially if you get in spasm now.
Maybe challenging.
No, but we discussed
left radial, just, you know, because they have such a large pannus sometimes. So it can be challenging, yeah.
Okay, we are comfortable to the right side. I think this is also one of the recommendations is to start from whatever you prefer. This is one, and also she's still, kind of, yes, she is obese, but I think I don't expect any subclavian persuasis or whatever. Anyhow, okay, I buzzed this area, so I would like to see whether my way is paved or not beyond this obstruction, as I think very, very clear. Nice pathway. So it was very nice. So right now I would like just to count how many problems we are having right now. So we added to these problems high radial takeoff with intense radial artery spasm. And unfortunately I didn't give and I cannot give any nitroglycerin just to improve this spasm. Okay. So I went from the past the subclavian, right subclavian, and each time my wire goes to selective to the right subclavian artery.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, so I think, So I think I mentioned this many times, the preferential passage of your wire to the right, to the descending aorta will be one of three. Either this is arterial zuria, this is pseudo arterial zuria, and this is right side aortic arch. One of them, one of three. I think this will be discussed next week, inshallah, how to solve all these problems. So anyhow, the one of the most important issues here is to document this is arterial zuria. This is a descending aorta, and the right subclavian artery originates right now from the right subclavian, from the descending aorta, confirming diagnosis of arterial zuria. So count with me right now, the number has increased arterial zuria in ischemic elevation, myocardial infarction, and cardiogenic shock. Any comment?
Well, I think Dr. Shahab's comments is very prescient here. arterial zuria can be very, very challenging, as you know. It's you can get a left coronary guide catheter in, and it's very, very supportive. The right coronary can be very challenging with lusoria. So I have gotten to the point in my life now where I don't even deal with these anymore, and I just go to the left side. When I was younger, I would try to tackle them, but now I just go to the left arm.
Okay. So, I think, thank you so much for that, but I have managed many patients with, not many, I think 6, 7, 8 patients with ischemic elevation, myocardial infarction, arterial zuria. I have a competency level just to cross, okay, the arterial zuria, and the next week I will be extremely happy if you can join us in the same time. We will discuss the issue of arterial zuria, how to recognize, how to solve this problem, step-by-step approach. So my competency level, I think, allows me just to go through the arterial zuria. Okay, how to solve, I think we'll postpone for next week. But just look for this picture, Prof. Rao, right now. My catheter, unfortunately, I couldn't reach or selectively engage left coronary artery, not because of the arterial zuria. It is not, Prof. Abdullah, because of the arterial zuria. It is because the intense spasm in the right right femur, okay, or the right the brachial artery or the high thickoff radial artery. Was intense spasm. It was moving with each movement of the catheter. The patient was screaming, "Oh my God! Oh, okay." So I think it was intense spasm, and I cannot move my catheter. Okay, very good. Okay, so I couldn't reach, but anyhow, I think from this picture, it is clear that left minder is, I think, very, very minimal disease, not significant. LED itself is not significantly diseased. This is diffuse disease, the obtuse marginal branch, diagonal branch as well also, but the RCA is included, 13 hours of presentation. Okay, so there is a radial artery or right coronary artery received retrograde collaterals from the left coronary artery. So I think we can add this issue right now, left catheter completely intrigued. And I couldn't push it or could withdraw it just to go from another approach. So left catheter intrigued with intense spasm. Okay. What to do? What is next? Yes, please.
Take a big breath.
Are you going to reach 10?
I took. I think wait and wait and see.
What's the
blood pressure?
Okay.
Blood pressure is very low. Okay. So I think what's the problem to give the patient just sedation by midazolam? Midazolam, I think, is a fantastic medication that we have to keep in our cath lab with other medications. And I think the pharmacology during transradial approach will be a separate session. It will be a very nice session as well. This is midazolam. Hypotic and sedative effect characterized by rapid onset and short duration. It also exerts as an anxiolytic, anticonvulsant, muscle relaxant. It causes minimal hemodynamic effect. So it is a fantastic medication that I use it frequently for any irritable patient. Okay?
I'm not sure if it doesn't cause hemodynamic effect. It's really cause too much hypotension, I think. If patient is already in shock, I don't know. I
mean, the reference down. Okay, and how the reference down? But just 2 milligrams, Prof. Abdullah.
Before the radial, doctor. This is before the radial, you know. So I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think.
Okay.
Mansoor, have you got an anesthetist?
Unfortunately, it was he was not available.
I think general anesthesia in these patients usually relieves the spasm and makes life easier. if they are available.
I did expect also, the bit.
And you can also do what's called flow-mediated vasodilation, where you can take the blood pressure cuff up above systolic pressure for about 10 minutes to 15 minutes, release it, and then the catheter oftentimes will just slide out.
Okay, but I don't know, it's an elevation of cardiogenic shock, so I think it was okay. Anyhow, the patient, I did expect the patient will calm down. Unfortunately,
sorry, Mansoor, what did Professor Rao said? What did he suggest?
There's a technique called flow-mediated vasodilation, where you can blow the blood pressure cuff up above systolic pressure and leave it there for about 10 to 15 minutes. It causes basically arm ischemia is what you're doing. And then once you release the blood pressure cuff, you get reperfusion of the arm. Oh. Whenever you have reperfusion, you get massive vasodilation.
Yes. Oh, okay. But already the patient is in significant vasoconstriction due to cardiogenic shock, or I think there is no time to do all these issues right now. So I did expect my patient will go to rest and the patient will be fine and everything. But unfortunately, the patient went into agitation, hallucination, and willing to go out. And we were almost 4 persons in the cath lab. And we were, all of us were controlling her just to, she was going to fall down from the table.
The table.
I think it was a hell. Our patient entered into what is called, unfortunately, midazolam paradox. This is the midazolam, what is the midazolam paradox? Okay, this is the paradoxical reactions to midazolam occur idiosyncratically with the clinical manifestations that include agitation, confusion, delirium, and hysteria, aggression, and restlessness. Okay, this is our situation right now. Okay, so fortunately, after a short time, the patient relaxed and the code withdrew the diagnostic left catheter, left radial done, as Professor Abdullah suggested from the beginning. It was an easy task to go from the left radial. Okay, RCA was totally occluded from the mid segment, balloon, the 2 stents done. Okay, and this is the final result. The patient did very well after that. Hemodynamics markedly improved on table. And just I would like to conclude because of sake of time, radial approach becomes the standard in acute coronary syndrome, non-segment elevation myocardial infarction as their guidelines. High risk features of bleeding necessitate, I think, radial approach. I think it's a must. I think it's the rationale of radial approach. However, radial pathway displays many variant anomalies that we have to know and have to know how to recognize and how to solve. And one of these will be discussed in the next session, inshallah. Prevention cardiologists performing transradial approach for coronary procedures should be familiar with all these vascular anomalies. Failure to recognize, I think, may add injury to the insult if you don't know. Timing and the route of crossover to alternative access site is of paramount importance in segment elevation myocardial infarction. Patient safety comes first. I was persistent to go through the radial approach. I will not cross over in this hugely markedly obese patient who was INR 2.2, and this patient fully anticoagulated. I think any hematoma, I think, may kill the patient, and this is beyond my insistence to do from the either radial approach. Thank you so much.
Excellent. What Dr. Rao said at the beginning, you know, the how and when and how, you know, so you had the tools and, you know, and you had the staff who are, you know, really helping you with this. And you know, if you are not going through the right, we've not learned all these complications. So it's beautiful. Thank you.
Would you leave the share screen, Mansoor, please? Okay. It was very interesting. I think we have spent enough of time. We were very happy to have you, Dr. Rao and Dr. Abdullah, with us tonight. It was very nice time for all of us, and I could read the messages from the audience that they enjoyed the talk and enjoyed this evening very much. We have Hani Atiba after 2 weeks. He will discuss acute coronary syndrome, the Glasgow protocol. We were very happy to have you and look forward to seeing you next time, inshallah. Dr. Rao, would you like to conclude anything?
I would just want to say thank you again for inviting me to this wonderful conference. It's really a fantastic job. I learned a lot and excellent cases. Thank you very much.
You are very welcome. Abdullah?
outstanding, the cases and the way you both of you, Dr. Allam, Dr. Rao, and Dr. Mansour, you made it simple and practical, and I think people now motivated to take it to radio.
Unfortunately, this technical issue happened. My computer, I think, was working since yesterday. I didn't switch off at all. I went to the hospital and went to my clinic, and I came back, and I think this may be my problem. So I do apologize for that.
Just to put a fan behind it, just to make it cool.
Okay. Here, inshallah.
Have a nice night. Thank you very much, all, and see you next time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.